Brothers and sisters, friends, I want to speak to you about the subject called Why is the Church in this Conflict? Why is the Church in this conflict? What conflict am I talking about? I'm not talking about wars that's going on. I'm not talking about the coronavirus or any other so-called conflicts or negative things that we experience. But what I'm talking about is a much bigger, much wider, much older, much more significant conflict. And we read of this conflict, it's not the only place where we read about it, but more specifically, and what where we're going to start this morning is Revelation chapter 12, 13, and 14. Now, we're not going to cover all of that this morning. We're just going to cover the first six verses of chapter 12. But I'm just want to, as an introduction to about this conflict and everything, want to say a few things. The book of Revelation, and then specifically chapter 12, and then also in a broader sense, chapter 12, 13, and chapter 14, is not a dramatized story. It's not a dramatized story. It's dramatized reality. Dramatized reality. A story is something that's not true. That's not really real. It's just there to entertain us. But reality is something else. It's not there to entertain us. It's dramatized not to entertain us. It's dramatized to give us a very important and urgent message. God is speaking through this dramatic words and this dramatization. And he's describing for us in these three chapters things that we need to know about the reality of the spirit world that we find ourselves in. We are part of the spirit world around us. We are part of the spirit world of heaven. We are part of the spirit world of the second heaven as well. Because we are, as human beings, we are spirit beings. And God, actually through these three chapters, not only these three, but specifically these three that we are focusing on now, are giving us a look into the reality which we cannot see with our physical eyes. God communicates to us spiritual reality through all the symbols and metaphors and picture language which we're going to read in these chapters. God gives us an understanding of the spiritual war in which we are involved and in which we, whether we know it or not, are directly influenced by and which we also take part in. We take part in the spiritual war, whether we like it or not, whether we know it or not, we do. But the main reason why God gives us this perspective is to have perspective. Why does God give us perspective? What does perspective do? If you have the right perspective, you're encouraged. Encouraged for what? Encouraged to stay the course and to stay faithful to the Lord Himself. Our very lives depend on this perspective, of this reality that we find ourselves in. Our lives depend on it. Our eternal destinies depends on this perspective. God is giving us this dramatized reality because he wants to show us the reality of the spirit world which we live in and of the reality of its direct influence upon this natural world which we live in. We, me and you, even though we are Christians, even the non-Christians are directly, not indirectly, directly influenced by the spirit world. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just telling you what the Word of God is saying. We will look step by step through these passages. But this is what God is saying to us and what God is showing. And therefore, it will be a foolish thing if we will ignore this. That God does not want us to be in ignorance. Not at all. The devil wants us to be in ignorance because why? Then he will immobilize us. We will not know what's going on. We will not know what to do. We will fall prey to his schemes and plots. But God does not want that. And that's why God wants us to show it to us, because then we will be equipped in how to fight these battles and how to be victorious in this life. God gives us this dramatized reality description here of the conflict of the spirit world and how it extends into this natural world which we live in. Because there's a war going on. Now, it's not that God is threatened and God is trying to overcome the devil and so on, because Jesus Christ has already done that. But there's still a conflict going on between the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of darkness. Because men and women on this earth, their lives are at stake, and there's a war going on for their lives and their eternal destinies. The human inhabitants of this earth, their eternal destinies are at stake in this war. And that's why this war and this conflict is so fierce. Maybe now you can understand why you many times experience the conflict that you experience. Not because there's necessarily something wrong with you, but because of the nature of the reality that we find ourselves in on this side of eternity. The devil comes and try to deceive people, and he get it right. The devil succeeds in that a lot with unbelievers. In what way? Because he deceives them to join his rebellion and his revolt against God. But he is not only busy and destroying unbelievers' lives, he also come to persecute and withstand believers as well. And as we will see later on, he does it mainly through humans, human beings, and earthly means. But God also gives us this dramatized reality description of the spiritual world, because God wants us to show us the reality of the eventual outcome of this conflict. This conflict is not going to draw on and on and on and on forever. This conflict and this war is going to come to an abrupt end in the future. We don't know how long it will still be, but God promises us and shows us in these passages it's going to come to a crushing end, where God's going to crush all the whole revolt against him. And so on. We will go into that a little bit more in detail later. Now this chapter 12, chapter 13, and chapter 14 is basically a dramatized summary of the whole of redemptive history. It's like a portion of the book of Revelation that is sort of, in a sense, loose from the rest of the book of Revelation. However, it does cover the same subject matter of the book of Revelation, but just in a completely unique way. It's like an interlude. Everything up to chapter 11 stops there, and then from chapter 15 onwards, it continues. But here, there's as if there's a pause, and God gives us a new drama to show us this war and conflict, where it came from, how it's playing out in this time of history where we are in, and how it's going to end. So it covers the time from creation until the day that Jesus Christ returns. Chapter 12 focuses more on the origin of the conflict between the two kingdoms, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of the devil, and the kingdom of God is by far the superior kingdom, and the kingdom of the devil has no chance against the kingdom of God. But there is this conflict because people's lives on earth are at stake. Chapter 13 gives us more specifics of the war that Satan is making against God's saints, and also how God helped his people in this war, to be victorious in this war. Then chapter 14 is a description of Christ's final dismantling and crushing of this age-old opposition and rebellion which are going on against God, and the opposition of the forces of darkness against God's people. How Christ will come and finally deal with all the unrighteous. And in all of this, while now here on earth, while the conflict is going on, while the war is going on, God in everything gives his people a sure way of ultimate, wonderful victory. We do not have to be the losers. God has given us a way and a sure way to win. We're going to look at that more in the following passages. So let's look at, and let's go and read at Revelation chapter 12 from verse 1 to verse 6. Verse 1. Now a great sign appeared in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. Verse 2. Then being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. Verse 3. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 diadems on his heads. Diadems are crowns. Verse 4. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born. She bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up to God and his throne. Verse 6. Then the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Let's first go and have a look at where has this conflict and war originated from. Verse 3 and verse 4, the first part, is what I'm going to start with. I'm not going to start with verse 1 and 2 and so on now, because I want us to first go and see, where did it start? It didn't start in verse 1, didn't start in verse 2. It started in verse 3 and the first part of verse 4. It says a sign appeared in heaven. This conflict, my brothers and sisters, friends, may sound strange, but it originated not on earth. It didn't originate with us. It didn't originate between people. It didn't originate between the devil and people. It originated in heaven, where God is. It didn't originate from him, from God. It originated from the devil. In verse 9, if you read further, it says that this dragon, from whom it originated, is actually, it's revealed here in verse 9, it says it is the devil and Satan. The dragon hasn't always been the devil or the dragon. There was a time where he wasn't the dragon, where he was good, because God made him. But he turned on God. He rebelled against God. He probably wanted to be God. He wanted to be worshipped and so on. And he rebelled. And where God is, as the scriptures tells us, where the domain and the dimension where God lives and where his throne is called the third heaven. And this conflict originated there. The rebellion started there. So we can see here, and I don't know, we can say a lot about how it happened and so on, but I don't want to spend time on that. We don't have time for that. But we can see here in this passage that we've read that the dragon, which is the devil or Satan, he is the central figure and source or origin of this animosity and conflict and war against God and against God's people. But it started there. It started there probably, the Bible doesn't explicitly say that, it probably started there even before the heavens and the earth were created. Or it might have started while the earth was already there. I don't know. But anyhow, in the Old Testament, a lot of the symbolic language that we find in the book of Revelation is borrowed from Old Testament concepts and Old Testament language and symbols. And in the Old Testament, serpents and sea monsters are usually used to describe evil forces which opposes God and God's people. And therefore, God went and borrowed that concept from the Old Testament and used it in the book of Revelation in the New Testament, because the initial readers of the book of Revelation were well acquainted with the concepts and symbols and figures of speech and metaphors of the Old Testament. So, therefore, the devil is described as a dragon, and a very fierce, fearful dragon. It says he is a great dragon. Remember, the Bible says here in verse 3, "And I saw another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon." It's the Bible that says it's great. It's not the whoever else that says he's great. It's God that describes the devil as great. And the term great basically refers to the might and the power and the ability Satan has to destroy. Jesus says that the devil is from the beginning, since the time that he started to be the devil and Satan, he is a killer of human beings from the start. He's a murderer. Satan does have the ability to destroy lives, and he has not lost that ability. He is still in the business of destroying. If you can just think for yourself, he started in heaven. He didn't start on earth with the destruction. He started there, and he started with his destruction in the third heaven. He started to deceive angels that were from the time that they started to exist, from the time that they were created, they were in the presence of God. They knew no sin, and he succeeded in deceiving them to turn on God, which is destruction in its very essence. Rebellion against God is self-destruction. The devil had the ability, the great ability. God gave him abilities, not to deceive, but he used that ability which God gave him against God. It also said he is a fiery red dragon, which basically tells us of his character of violence and bloodshed. Violence to destroy, bloodshed, killing, destroying, murdering, cruel. It says he has seven heads. Seven in this context just mean complete, and heads refers to earthly kingdoms and earthly powers over the kingdoms of the earth. It means, it refers to complete earthly power and rule of the rule of Satan, which he has over the unredeemed world. And he uses that earthly powers and rule to dominate, to intimidate, to deceive, and to force his influence and agenda in and through and upon this world. It also says he has 10 horns. 10 horns, just in short here, refers to his widespread evil power. His widespread power. You cannot go to any part of the earth where he does not have that kind of influence and power and strategies. It talks about the seven diadems on his head, which are seven crowns. And that also basically just emphasizes the seven heads of his earthly kingdom powers, where he has real power over the kingdoms and the forces, earthly forces and powers and so on. But we must also understand with that it's not nearly even equal to the power and the rule and the might of the King of Kings. That we must know. It is by far inferior to the power and the kingdom and the glory and the lordship of Jesus Christ, who is the King of Kings. But it also says here in verse 4 that he used his tail to draw a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. Now, his tail, and why the Bible talks about and why God uses this term, his tail, is because a dragon or a serpent or a crocodile or so on, a reptile's tail is usually a symbol of the lie. And now, it was not like that in the original Greek, but in English we can say it as this, that the Bible in our language here is basically, it's very close to like a word play, that he used his lie, his story, his tale, T-A-L-E, and not his tale, T-A-I-L, but he used his tale, his lie, to drew and to sweep away with his deceptive lie. He swept away a third of the stars, a third of the angels of God, to rebel and revolt against God, as he did. He deceived them. The stars, why are the angels described that he deceived as stars? Because angels are clothed with the glory of God. You do not have to look very far in the Bible to see that angels, even now, the angels in heaven are shining. When you see them, they are shining with the brightness and the glory of God himself. And they lost that in their rebellion. That's part of their fall. They were not only physically thrown out of heaven and thrown down to a lower state of existence, but they also lost the radiance and the glory which they carried of God. They lost it when they fell, when they bought into the lie of the dragon. It says Satan drew a third of the angels, which basically just mean the minority. The majority stayed faithful. And to use the symbol of a third means that those who remain faithful to God are twice as many as those who have rebelled. So only even on a numeric level, on an angelic level, the devil is outnumbered 2 against 1. And then God himself is not even yet in the picture. He's not factored in yet. So what God wants us to also know here, yes, there's a rebellion going on. Yes, there's destruction going on. Yes, we are in a conflict, but those who are with us are by far, even just in angelic terms, by far outnumbering the enemy. Isn't that good news? They were through, his tail through them to the earth, the Bible says. What does it mean to be thrown to the earth? They believed the lie, they fell into rebellion against God and lost the shining glory of God. Now, it's not really the devil as much which threw them out. It was God, but the devil initiated their fall, their rebellion. And because of their rebellion, they were rejected out of heaven and they fell and were not allowed to be in God's presence anymore. They were thrown to the earth. Now we know, we do not see the devil physically around here. We do not see demons around and so on. God can reveal them to us in the spiritual realm. It's very possible that God can do that. But in a general, normal sense, we do not. But what it means when they were thrown to the earth, they were thrown down to the second heaven. It means they were thrown and subjected to the spirit dimension, which is directly around the earth, so to speak. And out of that dimension, they exercise their influence on the earth and the earthly kingdoms and so on, which are at the moment in rebellion against God. I'm not saying nations, the physical nations are in rebellion, but we are talking about the earth, the structures of the earth, which are utilized by the devil to let his purposes be done. Now, here we come to this question of this message today. How did we as church, how did we as human beings get involved? How did we got involved into this conflict? Because it originated in heaven. And here we're going to find in verse 1 and verse 2 and also verse 4 and 5, God's going to show us something here, and he uses the representative of the human race and then specifically of God's people, he uses a woman to describe them. So when God talks about the woman, he's not talking about Mary, the mother of Jesus. He's talking about a collective people. And it's more specifically the people of God. It says, a great sign appeared in heaven. It means also this woman, this people of God. And then more specifically, let us be very straightforward here this morning. It talks about you and me. We as God's people originated from heaven. We were created in heaven in the sense of we have our origin and our citizenship and our belonging in heaven and from God. We originated and originate from God. And it also says that this sign of the woman is a great sign. The sign of the dragon is just another sign. But when he talks about the woman, it says a great sign. It means the stature and the glory and the magnificence of the woman, of the people of God, is far, by far superior than that which the dragon has. And my brothers and sisters, for those of us who know the Lord Jesus Christ, who belong to Him, who believe in Him, He's talking here about you and me. This is us. It's not what we are going to be one day. It's already what happened here in chapter 12. It's not what happened in eternity. It happened on this side of eternity here on earth. Now this woman, to make a long story short, is basically, there's two categories here. The woman in described in verse 1 to verse 5, and then the woman described from verse 6, is the same group of people, but the first part from where we read from verse 1 to verse 5 is actually the Old Testament people of God. And the woman from verse 6, after Christ has completed his work, then this woman is now the New Testament people of God. You can say the Old Testament people of God is those who were the Israel of God in the Old Testament. The New Testament people of God is now the New Testament Israel of God, but it's still the people of God as a whole. You cannot really separate the two because it's one people. Just in one people, some of them you lived under the old covenant time, and another people live now under the new covenant time, but it's still the same people. It says that this woman was clothed with the sun. Now, this basically refers here to the woman who is clothed and has the character of the glory of Christ and the glory and the radiance of Christ Himself and of God Himself. It says that she's got the moon under her feet, which means basically it refers to her dominion, because the sun, she's clothed with the sun, the moon is under her feet. The sun is always superior to the moon in glory, in stature, in size, in effect. And she is clothed with the sun, the moon under her feet. It talks about her dominance, her dominion, her rulership, her reigning with God. It says she's got a garland of 12 stars, which talks about her royalty, a victor's crown, which she receives from God. 12, and the 12 stars means the stars also has the glory of God. The 12 refers to the 12 tribes of Israel. And we are also part of that. We are not the natural Israel, but it's about the Israel of God, the real chosen ones of God, the Israel of God, His 12 tribes. It means she belongs to God. She's been chosen by God. She's the property of God. But it says here in verse 2 that she was a pregnant woman in labor, ready to give birth, which refers to Israel, through whom the Messiah in the Old Testament would come. Now, here's something extremely important. Ask yourself, why was she pregnant with the male child? Why was the child to be born through her into this world? Why? And I'm just going to summarize it here. You probably already know that. The reason for that child to be born is because men, the human race, fell into sin and had to be redeemed of their sin. That's why the male child was given. And he had to be born as one of us so that he can take our sin guilt and die with it as one of us, so that the penalty for our sin can be paid for in full. And he rose from it, from the dead. God, he rose Jesus from the dead because, excuse me, because his sacrifice for our sin was accepted. And he ascended to heaven because he had to prepare our place for us and give us entrance into the presence of God. So there was also not only the conflict that originated with the dragon, but there's also a second conflict, is our rebellion as human beings with Satan against God. And God had to give a remedy to rescue us from that. And that's why the male child, Jesus, had to be born and to complete his salvation work on our behalf. And we, the male child that was born, you by now know, it's talking about Jesus Christ and his birth and his coming to the earth. God's gift of our salvation in Jesus Christ. But here is something, and I want to start to close. And it says in verse 5 that she bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. What does it mean when it says that this Jesus, this male child who was born, he was to rule the nations with a rod of iron? What does that rod of iron and that ruling with a rod of iron means? And I'm just going to summarize it here. This ruling with a rod of iron is not taking place now. It's going to take place one day at his return. Because a rod of iron is not a shepherd's rod. That's the rod that brings salvation. But the rod of iron brings destruction. Not in a way that devil brings destruction, but it talks about how God's going to deal with his enemies and those who rejected him as God in their lives. It talks about to rule with a rod of iron. You can see if you read Psalm 2, verse 7 to 9, Psalm 2, verse 7 to 9, it's this language of the rod of iron was borrowed from Psalm 2, verse 7 to 9, where it talks about the Son of God, that when he returns one day, he's going to deal with the enemies of God and those who rebel against God, the devil and his angels, but also more specifically, the people who joined in the revolt against God and against the Son of God, how God's going to shatter them like pottery with his rod of iron, where they're going to be broken, where they're going to be destroyed, where they're going to be tormented and suffer the consequences in eternal damnation because of their choice against God. But now, until then, God gives a way of escape from being part of those that will be ruled with his rod of iron. Of a way of escape from his harsh rule that will come over the enemies of God. That's the very reason why the child was born and given to us. So I want to ask you today, some of you who look at this video, who watch this video, you are saved. And I want, and God wants to come to you today and want to encourage you to stay faithful, stay the course, stay faithful to the Lord. Don't let your guard down, don't fall asleep. But for those of you who might watch this video and you do, and who have not committed yourself to the Lord Jesus Christ, I want to ask you, what have you done so far with a child that was born? Have you already made use of the way of escape from the iron rod of the Son of God that's on its way? I'm asking you. This is the very reason why this message is going out today, to give opportunity for those who have not used that way of escape to make use of it. Where do you stand? Do you stand with the dragon or do you stand with the Son of God? And I'm going to pray, and if you want to give your heart to the Lord, I want to give you the opportunity. God wants to give you the opportunity to make right with Him. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the good news of Jesus Christ. Thank you also that though we are as children of God in this conflict, we have been given a sure way of overcoming. That you are encouraging us to stay the course and to stay faithful. We also pray, Lord, for those who are watching, Lord, who have not yet accepted and embraced you, Lord Jesus, as Lord and as Savior, who have not put their faith in you and you alone for salvation. Will you keep on working in their hearts to turn their hearts and to turn their lives to you in the name of Jesus? And Father, those of us, those of them who are watching now, who is saying, but Lord, now I come, I turn to you and I'm sorry for my rebellion against you, that I joined the devil in rebellion. Lord, I ask for forgiveness and salvation. Thank you, Lord, that you are saving them now and bringing them also into the kingdom, into your kingdom, and make them part of this woman that we are reading of now, who belongs to you, who are clothed with the glory of God. In Jesus' name we thank you, Father, for your mercy and your love and your salvation. Amen.